So before we go to the, we also have done the latest trend in terms of a PowerPoint presentation. But if there are any points, any clarifications that you need now in terms of certain explanations, most of this we will share it with you later on in terms of the presentation and the other things that we do today as part of the study. Since our engagement will continue, you know, as an ongoing basis, to see how we can push it through. But if there are any queries or questions on the presentation that was made just now, to drive home a point in a very simple way, the basic outline of the Supreme Court directives on systemic reforms. And many of us are not aware of it because our involvements are on other concerns and issues, not on policing. So, yes, Bala.
I just want to ask you about the Supreme Court directives. Now, the Supreme Court issues directives on all kinds of things all through the year. Now, is what is happening to this subject pretty much on par with what's happening everywhere else? Or is this that this particular thing is even more seriously affected than what happens to most Supreme Court directives anyway?
See, now at the moment, Mr. Prakash Singh has gone because there is a level of contempt in terms of not implementing the directives, because practically all the states in the country have done only bits and pieces. It has not done in the line of the total, of the whole thing. Might you like to react to it?
Yeah.
I'm not restricting it just to this issue in other states, but on all subjects, wherever the Supreme Court is issuing directives, what's the ultimate fate of the directives? Are they just filed and forgotten, or
when the court and the citizens have been particularly diligent, there has been some changes. I always tell, a lot of people criticize me and CHRI for looking at the reforming of police through the lens of Mr. Prakash Singh's case. A lot of people say, but we could do much more by just looking on the ground. Or that Mr. Prakash Singh was a policeman and he is only interested in whether the police get properly transferred or don't get transferred. He's not looking at, and I don't care about all that. The basic thing is this 2008 judgment,
2006
judgment, dropped a stone in stagnant waters. Nothing was moving. Now within the police, within the legislature, within the Niti Aayog, you have people talking about what should we do with police. My worry, if you're looking at an all-India, pan-India perspective, is that the loudest voices, the voices that have got influence, is policing voices and bureaucratic voices, not our Indian civil society voices. So when the policeman meets a bureaucrat in the Niti Aayog and he says, tell me what you want, first thing they say is, why don't you trust us? Why don't you make confessions to the police allowable in court? Put that in the Police Act. And we, myself and a committee of others, official committee of others, on two occasions, once under Soli Sorabji and once under Mr. Kamal Kumar, who used to head up the National Police Academy, we have sat and created, at the behest of government, two model police acts. The latest Model Police Act is on the website, I believe, on the MHA, and you can find it on the website of CHRI also. And that is a much more progressive act. In terms of the Supreme Court, to answer your question specifically, the Supreme Court itself has been extremely muddled, careless, and absolutely neglectful of its own directives. Judges have changed, people have taken it from, at one stage, three judges were listening in different courts, not knowing that the other judges also listen. Then there are public interest litigations to insist that the PCA is formed as a result of that public interest litigation by Mr. Limbadri, actually the PCA was formed. But the PCA was formed in such a, you know, it's like birthing a child after giving the patient thalidomide. It's got no arms, it's got no legs, it's all twisted, it's no use to anything or anybody, and then they say, here you are, we have complied. The same with the State Security Board. if you look at Mr. Ribeiro's articles, he has written really strong articles to say, how dare you do this? How dare you commit this fraud on the people? But the State Security Commission, to my mind, is an extremely important priority for people. Okay, they've set up these things. They've set them up badly. So to make it work, Mumbai CERC must follow it, monitor it, document it, put it in the public domain that this is how they are treating us.
Sorry, what is Mr. Ribeiro's argument? Can you say that, share that a bit in detail?
Mr. Ribeiro says that we had directives in the Supreme Court. They were a good beginning, but not sufficient. All policemen of that old type argue that if you have character, you can manage, which they did, but they did in a different environment. But I also agree with that argument, that if you have character, then you should be able to do this. But if all the odds are stacked against you and the fellow doesn't have character, then it is up to the public. In fact, though he is so respected and he writes very clearly and everybody knows what he thinks, and all the police chiefs of Bombay will touch his feet, in the end, nobody follows because their careers and everything else. There are problems with the police structure. Everybody who has made police reform suggestions have assumed that this is the structure we have to work with. This linear structure, the discipline, the militaristic pattern, isolating the police from the public, giving them their own lines. When I'm asked about these things, I work within the structure, sadly, because that's the only conversation that goes forward. But really, if you think about it, this police should have been changed radically at independence. And then radically after Punjab, or radically after Gujarat, or radically after the emergency. But we haven't taken those constitutional moments which we should have taken. So now, what are we going to do?
So what, any more questions? Yeah.
Yes, can you give us a little background of Prakash Singh's case? Short background.
Sure.
Give it. Because I cannot connect the discussion anywhere without knowing that particular case.
See, we had almost eight series of reforms that were recommended over a period of time. But nobody, those books, the eight volumes books, remained in the cupboards of the Home Ministry. Nobody was touching it.
They're actually eight volumes.
Physically.
National Police Commission.
Okay. Over a period of time, right from the day of the independence, after that. So they remained, as usual, very good structural changes, etc., etc. So Mr. Singh, who was a former DGP of Uttar Pradesh and Director General of Border Security Force, after he retired, he filed a petition in the court to say why these things are not being implemented. And the Supreme Court then distilled it in those six directives that I have shown to you now. Simple six things, which we will again drive home the point how important they are. Each and every segment of that is important in terms of a structural change of better policing at the ground level. So that's more or less in very short the description of how the Prakash Singh thing came in. Okay. But as Maya did suggest, is that that's only a starting point. Because somewhere we have to begin. People have resistance to the Prakash Singh judgment from several aspects. But what they are saying is, we have to begin somewhere. And then we can start demanding in terms of certain aspects that are there. For instance, I'll give an example. One of the arguments was that the Supreme Court cannot make the law. It is the responsibility of the state to make the law. So that was where the problem was happening. So they said, these are directives. We will decide, the states will decide, because police being a state subject, they will decide how they want to take the directives. And what was very funny in Maharashtra was that in 2014, because the Supreme Court was breathing down their necks to say, what the hell are you doing about implementing this? They said, we will do a law. So first they introduced an ordinance. that ordinance was in total contravention of the Supreme Court directives. Okay. So, and nobody knew about it. Normally, when you make a law, you know, it's always to take people into consideration. Consultations have to take place with the stakeholders. But nowadays, nobody bothers about the stakeholders. They decide, let's say the assembly, they decide we must introduce this. The cabinet decides, okay, we must introduce this. So, they introduce first through the back door an ordinance to show to the Supreme Court that we are doing something.
Okay.
Then, we all protested. We not only protested, but we asked for time also for the governor. So, ordinance was, and because in 6 months time the ordinance, if it doesn't, it gets lapsed. Alright. Then they presented in the assembly. Nobody knows about it. Hardly any discussion in the assembly. It was passed. It went to the legislative council. There again only one lone member, only Pandit in the assembly made a noise about it. Nobody else raised the point. When it went to the council, and that time remember one thing, BJP was in the opposition. So only Ashish Shelar raised the point to say that let it go to a select committee. They bypassed it and they passed it to the governor. So when we came to know about it, we discussed with Mr. Rivero, we asked for an appointment. Satyanarayan was the governor at that time. And very interestingly, we met him, I think it was June 24th of 2014. We met him, we had a lavish breakfast, tea and breakfast and all that thing with him. Spent 2 hours with us. He says, first of all, he says, as a governor, I have very limited powers. This was his opening statement. But yet, because you all have raised this point, I will talk to the chief minister and send him a note. And what had happened was that we met him on June 30th, I remember the date. And then we get a call from one of our journalists on July 15th to say, did you all know that the governor had signed the bill on June 24th?
So in other words, he was a lying hound.
So we want to tell you this, but what is happening is that because there has been no sufficient outcry, then you get away with this sort of a thing. So we want to give you a little perspective on the current status and maybe still drive home the point of an explanation to you again to know exactly how important some of the directives are in terms of a message that we want to do, because this becomes our starting point in terms of understanding, and we can look beyond. We are saying let's also look beyond the Prakash Singh judgment. This is only a starting point. Okay, yeah.
We always say ki this is not raised up by civil society. Right? Now, police reforms actually come way below in the priority of any civilian, if you really look at it.
Yes.
So, if I'm a law-abiding citizen, I'm not bothered by police and other things. So, laws and other things and court cases and directives by Supreme Court is not something that interests me. Right? I think the context of bringing that in, that interests is the people who are in the know of the judgment and can do something about it. Right? I'm talking of the activism or activists present in those areas of interest. So when I look at it, when we talk in these walls here, I think most important is to first take down the importance of why the police has to be, why the citizen has to be conscious about police and its police laws, and how important, irrespective of whether a law abiding citizen or not. So that has to be, that is not perpetuated down the line to the citizens. So therefore you find these things don't come as a priority to citizens or citizen activists also, unless you clash with the law at some point of time, like if it happened with the five activists arrested, then generally you know you need to seek something in the law, whether it was right, wrong, whatever. So this would be a generator, but still for the public at large,
so
that's not priority.
Do you have any thought, or anybody here has a thought, how can we generate this interest? See, we are all the time searching for this because we've been talking to groups, individuals, networks, and we want ideas.
First thing, I think, if I have to give an idea, I think this has to be laid down for a training, slide project. And It has to be first started to disseminate to collective people who are studying, like for example colleges.
Yeah.
Colleges as a major thing. And students, because you have developed a book, you know, it is very, very simple. Students do not know, but at least at student level of 8, 9, 10, around that, there's something that they would still better understand. Then parents, teachers, associations. Very, very important, you know, thing of society. People work. See, these are things to be tapped. Teachers' community. You know, the bonded communities which are available, anywhere it can be, has to be tapped. You know, housing societies, wherever people meet for many other things. I think these are things to be tapped. Maybe it has to be started small in one area as pilot projects and looked at the implementation as well as the outcomes. And taken
so, so we are giving an offer to all of you that we are available here. You can organize
yes.
groups. We are willing to come and talk to them to start the process, and then you in turn, you would.
Yes.
What we are doing today is to give you an idea where you pick up certain things, we are willing to give you the material, we are willing to come. Just a week back, we had a rundown of over 800 students of St. Xavier's College of second year. Over a period of a week, we did the introduction of this whole theme, topic, etc., etc., policing, ground level policing. So, the question is, we are telling it back to citizens that please organize programs, we are willing to come there, we are willing to back you up with resources, we are willing to come and talk to your groups, we are willing to do that. You know, so that is one option which we fully agree with you, that we need to keep on talking, and we are doing it to build it up as part of the whole question about generating the buzz for them to say, let's do it. So that's the offer we give you. Yes, John?
I've got a suggestion. One of the biggest promoters of myths of policing is our serials and our films.
Yes.
If we can take and make, have a small group, whenever something wrong is being said, oh, this is the procedure, when it is wrong, if we can write and make a small this thing and put it, it probably will get, so that people at least know that, okay, this is illegal. I mean, like a cop and can come, like you have in the series, yes, on, what is that? Girl whose whole, the house come, people, a cop said, is coming in, throwing things down, around, you know? He's taking a vase and throwing it against the wall.
But John, I just want to, I love the idea and I think we should do it. But I want to tell you that we have a vast resource in Bombay. Vast resource. We have two people. One, two. So they need your hands. They need your muscle. And one of the things we're trying to do also is to get hold of the media. It's just not easy. We were talking yesterday, and I was talking about the difference between being an advocate for right to information. Everybody picks it up like that. And being an advocate for police reform, go away. You know, it's too difficult, too dangerous, too obscure. But we have to make it. We have to link it to our lives. We have to link it to the idea of citizenship, freedom, justice. And one of the best things that happened to me in the last year, or maybe 5 years, is that judgment of Justice Chandrachud. So I've been clinging on to it in the wind, you know, in the hope that we'll see somebody or something.
We could organize one presentation to the Screenwriters Association.
I'm just going to say that we do have actually tangible resources to put John's idea into action. So
wow.
We'll take that offline.
Excellent.
Because Whistling Woods is open to having such things included in their formal curriculum for their
Lovely.
Writers.
Lovely.
And also there's the Screenplay Writers Association itself, which is very large. I mean, it has thousands of members. So I think that's a very tangible.
For the next annual meeting, we can plan
yeah,
a session.
We can work on this.
And
okay.
Not only that, we can issue them a threat that if any story of yours has a thing which is illegal, we are going to write and we are going to create a sting. So then before they do write the story,
yeah.
They find easy ways out of situations, right? You create a
situation.
And then you have to get out of it, so jaldi marke aise story ko phira dete hain with the totally illegal stuff. So we have to issue them a warning, like we will get after you as a bad screenplay writer.
I mean,
where
have
you been all my life? This is not a moment for a detailed discussion of this, is it? No, no. So we pick up that idea. The idea, see, if you recall in the last QCL meeting, I had suggested that we could have a subgroup on police reforms, and I'm willing to work with the thing to take this idea forward as part of the network with the QCL. So we can evolve it, because we meet every month, to evolve it in terms of taking these ideas and take it down at the ground level.
See, every effort is worthwhile in its own right. But if you're talking about emphasis, and the way I look at this is something like this, that we need to emphasize on the younger people through the media that they are used to. None of them read the newspaper, none of them watch TV either. So if it doesn't appear on their mobile, it doesn't exist for them, whatever you may say. So now if this is that bunch of people whom we are looking at for change, and we can see it, the beaches in many places are being cleaned by youngsters, not by people of our age who are sitting and, you know, fiddling off lands and step on step and all that. These are people who just don't do it, you know. So I was wondering whether we need to continue with everything we are doing, but put a little more emphasis on social media and talking to youngsters.
Okay. And I would just add, in all fairness to all of us as general janta, which we are at the end of the day, maybe the onus is on us, you know, to provide very tangible, small, doable things. So then his point would kick in there, that and do it over mediums that the young people are engaged in, because how to break down the size of the mountain into small actionable bits, and I think you're going to do that. So maybe we are getting ahead of your talk.
No, it's okay. No, but see, we have been connecting with the young people. Yeah, Dev.
As far as Bombay Police is concerned, they have a very active Twitter handle. In fact, the Commissioner of Police has his own handle. The Traffic Police have their own Twitter handle, and they respond very fast. There was a time when reaching the Commissioner of Police in Mumbai was almost impossible. Today, he gets your message in 5 seconds flat. And when you retweet with a comment or suggestion, it does get action. So,
right.
But people are scared of the police, you have to understand that. Even when you're tweeting something with the police, say, people will just say like and retweet. Very few people address the problem on the Twitter thing and say, this is what you should be doing. Now there was, I'll give you an example. Somebody tweeted that I got a phishing call, somebody wanted my bank account details or some insurance policy detail. The routine reply was go and contact the nearest police station. They didn't say you'll waste the rest of your life getting your FIR, whatever.
Right.
But I just wrote back saying, why don't you set up a cell to specifically deal with these kind of complaints?
Right.
Now that I also added the CP's handle on that, so that message went to the Commissioner of Police. Now something will start happening at that level.
Yes.
Now if 500 people start saying similar things on Twitter, they will actually sit up and do things.
So in the post-lunch session, what we try to do is to create a sort of hobbies list of 25-30 things that you feel like doing. And if you can add to that list, great. And I would like all your suggestions, just like you said just now, sir, on prioritizing, because we also, you know, we get lost in the woods. So whenever you show a pathway, then we come to it. And we are going to colleges. But when you go to colleges, they kind of listen to you, but then they've got 1,000 different things to do. But who have we actually, whose brain have we actually got into, and whose we haven't? It's like eating salad. It's good for you, but you don't feel good enough. You eat a nice fat paratha, and you know that you're full, and it's okay. It's just that difference. It's so hard to keep going when you can't see the results. But that's what we're trying. That's why we're with you. This is a parent-teacher meeting. This is not with the kids. This is with the educated elite of the civil liberties movement that we track. That's why it's at a higher level.
So maybe not being cynical to what you have said about this Twitter handle, because that's what we're talking about, police accountability. It's very interesting to observe that when Mr. Dattatreya Phadsalkar was the police commissioner. He actually insulated himself from meeting citizens. He was out of bounds because he would always delegate responsibilities to his juniors down the line in terms of the messages. Total invariance to what Mr. Rakesh Maliya did of keeping his doors open to meet citizens. Practically every day between 4 and 6, where more than 100-150 citizens would be in the property market office to meet each one of them. And police down the line knew that inka kaam nahi kiya yahan pe to ye police commissioner ke paas jayega. But Salke then, when he came in, because he had an IB background, intelligence bureau background, his approach changed totally. He started using this technology and other things. Now, what was happening very interestingly is that very creative messages would come on the Twitter handle of the police.
Yes, you do.
And they are remarkably done because it's a fantastic thing, you know. But the point would happen is that something very interesting that happened, but below that, when the replies come in, they would say, I send you a message on a complaint. You delegated it to the Joint Commissioner Law and Order. The Joint Commissioner Law and Order delegated it to a Deputy Commissioner of Police, and I'm running in circles for the last 2 months. This was the response coming to beautiful messages that were happening. So we also talking about the whole question is the status which has to be done, and we actually don't have a victims forum where you could use that voice of those who are facing struggles with the police. We don't have that. So we actually don't know how to create that demand, because that particular segment could be a very powerful voice on genuineness of the issue. So these are things that maybe we have to talk about in terms of police accountability of what happens. And I know for sure from our experiences, things don't happen down at the police station level. Unless you have connections, or you use clout, or you use civil liberty groups to raise that. An ordinary citizen cannot get even a hearing. Forget about justice, he doesn't even get a hearing about it. So we also need to creatively think how we can. In fact, we used to get suggestions, and we were discussing this that whether a private citizen's helpline, you have the police helpline of 100, and for women you have 103. A private citizen's, all the time the debate comes in, why don't you start a private citizen's helpline in reference to police? And we know we'll open a Pandora's box, because we don't have a wherewithal. The control room of the police for 103 and 100 number, there's a total of 60 police force manning that round the clock. So if you open it in terms of a private helpline, we know for sure it's going to open a Pandora's box, and we'll never be able to handle it. But we need to find innovative ways by which, and in fact, when we met Mihir also, he only said this, that when only custodial deaths happen, then there is a little bit of a pitch of people getting upset about it. But when people suffer because of the day-to-day policing, where your FIR is not lodged in, you are made to wait for sometimes hours on end, and we are not able to reach out. You see, the day we reach out to that segment, then you are creating a demand for better policing. So we need to look at it how, through our network, we can work this out very, very closely. So this is the dynamics that may come in terms of a discussion to draw up a priority list of what we need to do. Any other questions? Yes, Hasina.
I'm sorry, I came late.
Welcome.
No, yeah. We should let Hasina play that game because she came late.
Okay. Yeah, tell me, Hasina.
I accepted what you said. I just want to tell you this, Sherry, actually, it's implications is one level, but so many areas is those are the minority ghettos, religious minorities areas. This community, it's facing for the so many times in the patrolling. Whatever is happened for any festivals, any religious festivals. So ghetto,
are you on the mic? Yeah.
Minority ghettos is facing the patrolling and the very much.
One second. Sorry. Are you on the mic?
So the terrorizing the day-to-day level, it's very problematic too. So immediately help. Immediately
help,
because we have some lawyers groups.
Hello.
Yeah, but we have some lawyers groups. But this lawyers group is fighting in the court, not day-to-day level as a community and grassroots. So, you know, we can these kind of gap is in the Bombay city. I'm seeing this very. So is gap of how to fulfill this gap, the one level. The second thing is 103 helpline. They started 10 years before, but still we have a facing for this not properly working, not properly investigation, police reaching. If police reach the first time, but they not give the NC a complaint, some sleep something. So next time this women facing same thing is, and we have a more, we have a so many experiences. So 103 helpline is not properly properly reaching the, those are the areas poor people community, these kind of women is very, you know, like, so these are the gap we have to, what kind of we have to push the direction and what kind of support.
Hasina, I take your point very strongly. A little later on we'll come to tell you what we are trying to do in a small way, and also we'll talk to you offline about which areas these ghettos are in, and then see whether we can't combine our efforts with the community's efforts. So, but we'll take it offline if you don't mind for a little while.
But those points will definitely come in terms of our priorities, in terms of the action plan and some initiatives that have happened. We will definitely take it up at that appropriate time, but that point is noted. Any more questions before we go through the rundown to just to give you a little bit more insight? Yeah.
Just one.
Yeah, Sandhya, tell me.
I was just reading, I don't know whether it is now to be raised or later.
Tell me.
This actionable
measure. So we are taking it later on. As that's what Maya suggested, that we do, there are a lot of thoughts that are coming into that actionable measures. Then we need to prioritize in terms of what we should take it immediate and build it up, take the next one, because we can't do everything. But as a group here, we can then decide what steps from those actionable measures we could take it as part of our driving home the agenda for action at the ground level.
So after we watched that entire film, the documentary that we saw, that Supreme Court gave 6 major directives to every state government to be followed in order to bring about police reforms in some way. I would like to take those 6 directives but mainly emphasize on 2 of them, that is the Police Complaints Authority and the State Security Commission. And the State Security Commission. The reason being is that being civil society, where we can demand accountability at the basic ground level is at these 2 levels of the Supreme Court directives. So just running down all of them, basically we have, these were the 6 Supreme Court directives, that is basically the establishment of the SSC, that is the State Security Commission, the tenure and the selection of the DGP, the minimum tenure of the IGP and other officers, separation of investigation, law and order and other functions, the Police Establishment Board and the Police Complaints Authority.
So I just want to interrupt because there are 2 or 3 which will take a very brief thing. We say initially this could be the priority what Donita suggested, and the other one actually Police Establishment Board and Police Complaints Authority. But the other 3, I'll just quickly share it with you. Tenure and selection of DGP, it's provided that at least he should get a minimum 2-year tenure. But look at Maharashtra, what's happening consistently is, before Mr. Mathur took over, it was Mr. Dixit. Dixit had just 4 months tenure. So very well you can understand that a head of a police force, what can he do if he has a 4 months tenure? The similar thing happened with Satish Mathur, 6 months tenure. Now Mr. Patsarkar has just got an extension, so you will get maybe another maximum 6 months. So very specifically it is designed that you should at least give the man 2 years tenure, which is actually not happening for various reasons that are there. So those can go in later stage. Even for operational staff, when you say IGP and other officers are those who are involved in crime investigation and other things, again here somebody is investigating, within 4 months the guy is gone. So how does he perform? How do you have the ability to handle crime, investigations, or doing some important work or whatever is there? So there is no, absolutely no late track. Under the nomenclature that they use, which you saw in the doodle, under exigencies, a man can be transferred overnight. It's as simple as that. So the law has become, they have made it in such a vague term that you can have a discretion. Now, separation of investigation and law and order functions. We know for sure that when one of the senior officers at the level of the additional commissioner of crime very categorically told me, he says, our priority is law and order. A guy who is in charge of crime, number two man, he says very clearly, our priority is law and order, because at the drop of the hat, sometimes our citizens come and protest, there is a problem on the law and order, and there is VIP movement. If anything happens to the VIP, we are the first guys to be hit. So this is the thinking. But what is tragic is that in 2016, I think Sanjeev Dayal issued a circular to all the police stations in Maharashtra that by August 2016, he issued it in May, that every single police station will have a separation of
investigation
and law and order. It's 2016, we're in 2019 now. And what happened? Mr. Maria himself tells us privately, without discuss, we never brought it to his reference. He says, where are the people? He says, if we have to do a separate wing of crime investigations, we actually don't have the manpower. Because then we have to segregate them. So we mix everything, and then on the basis of that, we put in. So you can imagine the non-application of mine in terms of the aspect of having a separate, specialized crime investigation wing. That's the reason why now when outcry came in cyber, earlier there was only one cyber cell in Bandra. Because there was a momentum in terms of citizens raising it, now they have designated it that every single police station will have a cyber cell. With at least two people at a level of a sub-inspector and an inspector and one constable to be there. But what about the training? They're not trained at all.
To add on to that, they had a three-day workshop in Kalina University just to train them on how to take the complaint and what kind of complaints come. But only a three-day workshop, and there was no training given on how to investigate the entire process.
So these are ground realities that are there that we have to face. We need to also articulate this. So now the three important points and then we...
So this was a Supreme Court order that we saw was of the State Security Commission. Is basically that the composition should follow any of the three models that are already existing, that is the NHRC, the Ribeiro Committee or the Sarabji Committee. And it will generally include the Home Minister or the Chief Minister, the DGP, Leader of Opposition, etc., etc., as you can read. The functions of the state security had been clearly mentioned as they were to draft broad policy guidelines or evaluate the performance of the police, preparing an annual report to be placed in front of the legislature. Then their powers were also that their recommendations are binding to the government. Now, when it was implemented in Maharashtra, this is what happened. That the composition, it does not conform to any models. Like it does not follow any certain model that was recommended by the Supreme Court. It includes the leader of the opposition and five non-official members included, but no independent panel for their selection or removal. Means no one is responsible on whom to select, why to select, and their removal at the same time. Their functions are basically, there is no mention in their annual reports, and the powers are that their recommendations are not binding. Exactly opposite of that was recommended by the Supreme Court. Now this is,
can I just go back to the State Security Commission? You don't have to put it back.
Okay.
I just want to say, see, the State Security Commission is one of the major complaints and an abiding reason for lack of reform is the close connection between the politician and the policeman. At all levels now, if you go to UP and Bihar, the local thanedar really doesn't have to listen to his senior, because he's got his buddies who got him in there. He's got the buddies who help him to run that area. So he's on business on his own. He really doesn't need anybody above him. So the loyalties that you should have, the discipline that you should have, the structure that you should have, is all pokla. It's all gone. So, and all of this is because you have let in extraneous influences into incentivizing the behavior of the police on the ground. So the State Security Commission was meant to create a buffer body. What was intended was, in every state, like Maharashtra, the State Security Commission, most importantly, would be bipartisan. Would have the leader of the opposition and the
Home Minister.
It would have the Chief Secretary. It would have two or three other bureaucrats, but it would have five other members or several other members who brought in different disciplines, psychology, management, training, specialization or something, economics, and bring it together. And what would they do? They had three things, and you only have to remember this. They had to lay down policy. They had to look at provisioning. What do the police need? So if your policy was, you will make sure that crime against women and safety goes down, then what do you need for that? You need more women officers, you need more money, you need more training. So the provisioning was there. So the provisioning and the policy was to match. And then you had to evaluate the performance of the police chief. That meant that the police chief could not come back and say, sir, lekin aapne bol diya to humne kar diya. It was his job to get that work done, and all of this was to be reported annually to the legislature. So the legislature never left control over the police. But the control was supervised, was modified, so that you couldn't go behind somebody back. You couldn't give orders that was different. So it was constitutionally really the best way to do it. And beneath that, then you had all the stuff about the tenure and all that to give safety and security to the police leadership to do the things that you asked. So if you don't do the one, you can't do the other. So it was holistic. I'm sorry to interrupt you. Please.
And interestingly, when she's putting it down, nobody really knows what's the status of the State Security Commission in Maharashtra.
Yeah.
Okay. And nothing is there on their websites, nothing is there in the Chief Minister's website, Home Minister's website. Nobody knows about it.
This is something that civil society can RTI, monitor, and follow. We have done this with prisons, including looking at the minutes of their meetings. So that then you could start saying that, what are you spending this money on? If you've got five people and you're paying them, what the hell are they doing? Please.
So then comes the second one, that is the Police Establishment Board. It is basically a board that will decide on the transfers, the postings, etc. of the entire police system that exists. So it was based, the composition was of the Police Establishment Board is that it is to be set up in each police department, and it will have the DGP and four senior officers on it. The functions or the mandate of the PEB is basically to decide the transfers, postings, promotions and other service related matters of officers at the level of DSP and below, and the recommendations for they have the power to make a recommendation for the transfer and posting even at higher level. So that this also is basic, this was also recommended to keep away the political influence on the police system in matters of transfers and postings. They also have something known as the appeal forum, that was basically for the SP rank and above for grievances regarding anything, regarding promotions, transfers, proceedings or any illegal order. At the same time, the review was that the they would also have to review the functioning of the police in the state. So the performance of the police in the state, etc., had to be reviewed by the Police Establishment Board to work towards it. In Maharashtra, the police has the Police Establishment Board been?
Nobody knows about
nobody
it.
Nobody knows about it.
It has.
It has certain functioning, but as again here, the idea was that the postings, transfer and all should be given to the police leadership. Because ultimately, the guys should be answerable to them. But the way it has been basically formed is where, again, you go back to the additional chief secretary home, who is the head of that particular police establishment board, which means, again, the government, the political executive, through the IS guy, handles the whole question about postings and transfers. So at the end of the day, the police guys have no authority. Today, a police commissioner is not even authorized to appoint a constable. That's the state of affairs. So you have this anomaly that is there, that I am the boss of my department, but I have no authority to appoint a person in the department that work under me. So how do you function?
Not appointment, not promotion, not posting.
Nothing. He's got no authority. It has to go back to the home department, which means the chief minister will control through the additional chief secretary home. So at the end of the day, what police guys always say is that, why should I bother about my head of my department when I have a pipeline to the politician? It's a very clear conduit. That's why they don't follow instructions. If you look at it, they don't follow, although this is a hierarchical body, but still you have these patterns emerging which are not in place. We want it to be in place in the letter and spirit of the directive so that they have authority to appoint people. Once the guys down the line know that he's my boss and I'm answerable to him, then things fall in place.
So this is also part of the kind of IAS, IPS competition or rivalry
that is there
across the country.
Yes.
Which is, by the way, it's true for the army also. Even the army officers feel very, in a sense, oppressed by the IAS in many situations.
That's because their leadership is so weak.
Yeah.
I just want to say, as part of the PCA and subgroup, John and all of us were looking, you were also there, Haseena is also there, about this lynching. And this also has implications for mob lynching, because if you're, you know, whom do we pin accountability on? And if there is such a nexus between the politician and the police, then obviously they're going to take orders even on these matters from the political class, no? and all these extraneous elements. So when we are looking, I mean, we had formulated a small group that was looking at, you know, giving suggestions with regards to how do you address hate crime and mob lynching, and this is something which also has a bearing on that.
Absolutely.
That's true for both IPS and IAS. There, I don't think there's that much difference. Because both IPS and IAS officers have been penalized for documenting hate speech and asking and trying to take action and being stopped from doing so.
So in Maharashtra, as Dolphy spoke, the entire function of the police establishment board was basically to have a board within the police system to decide about their transfers and all. But in Maharashtra, the police establishment board has been split into two. So there is a level of DSPN below, which also decides the which is at a commissionerate level and which decides the postings, transfers and promotions, and these are taken as binding. And then there is another level which is above the DSP rank, which is the Police Establishment Board 1, to make recommendations for the same. Now the appeal forum is not stipulated, and the entire police establishment board is not mandated to review the functioning of the police. Like, they are not. That's not one of their functions according to the Maharashtra Police Establishment Board. Then the sixth directive is one of the most important directives that had been given by the Supreme Court, is where the citizens or the people themselves could raise complaints against the police, and which is why a police complaints authority had to be set up, which is set up in Mumbai, as Dolphy had earlier mentioned, but it still does not follow all the recommendations of the Supreme Court. So the composition of the Police Complaints Authority was basically, it had to be chaired by a retired High Court or a Supreme Court judge, and who shall be chosen out of a panel of names proposed by the Chief Justice. Then there are two Police Complaints Authority that needed to be set up, one at the state level and one at the district level.
So the state level should be chaired by a retired high court or a supreme court judge, and the district level should be chaired by a retired district judge who shall be chosen out of a panel proposed, panel of names proposed. Then the mandate at the state level was to inquire into cases of serious misconduct, including death, grievous hurt or rape in police custody by police officers of above the rank of a superintendent of police. And at the district level also it was the same thing, but also the police complaints authority at the district level was to look into cases of extortion or cases of misconduct of any police officer of any rank at the same time. So but in Maharashtra the police complaints authority at the state level is an officer not below the rank of special IGP as member, and an officer not below the rank of ADGP as member, and member secretary, one member from the civil society. All of this is set up, right?
Yes.
The PCA is set up. And so at the district level, it's a non-functional body right now. And the mandate of the state level includes the misconducts that the SC listed under the district level PCA is the same. And the district level also the powers of the state PCA apply mutatis mutandis. They're basically into preliminary investigation and then looking into these matters.
Something that I'd like to share on the police complaint authority. This, as Maya did mention, that this came about because one of our network people called Advocate Limbadri Bomer, he had his own personal case on the basis of which you filed a petition in the High Court to say had there to be a police complaints authority, I would not have had to come to the High Court and waste the time of the High Court, which could have been handled by the police complaints authority. So that petition was filed way back in 2014. It was only in 2017 end when the whole process started directing the state under some pretext, or it's a long story, how the mechanisms of delay deliberately are done, finance is not available, space is not available, manpower is not available. So finally in the last 7-8 months they have started functioning. Okay, at the state level, they are supposed to do it in the districts. They have not even implemented that, on the same excuse to say they are not getting a place, they are not getting staff, we have requisitioned staff and all that thing. So at the moment, but the funny thing is that the Supreme Court directive talks about it being, once the decision is taken by the PCA, the Police Complaint Authority, it has to be binding. But in case of the law that has been enacted, it is only recommendatory, which means the state can refuse to implement it. So ultimately it becomes a toothless wonder. So these are the things that we were discussing with Mihir. Because the letter and spirit of the Supreme Court directive versus what has been implemented, whether PUCL and me, we could work together to move the courts in terms of the implementation only Maharashtra. You know, so that is being explored in terms of research, study and all, which we will give it to Mihir to work on the PIL, and Mihir and his team also will look into the various facets. So those are things also that we can work together, because it has to be fought on two levels. One is the citizens' level of making this noise that is required, and on the other side, the legal aspect in terms of pushing the courts to intervene so that we have a proper functioning police complaints authority, which becomes mandatory once the order is given and it is implemented. Now what will happen is, even if you file a complaint, interestingly now, because there is no district level, every single complaint is coming to the state level. Okay, and what is happening today in Maharashtra, we have the State Human Rights Commission. There's a conflict that is going on, saying that if the State Human Rights Commission is there, why the hell should you need a police complaints authority? That's point number one. So there is this discussion. On the other side, the State Human Rights Commission, they have more than 3,500-4,000 complaints pending over a period of years. They are not been able to perform. So you have come to back to square one, and the police themselves are not interested in this police complaints authority, because it definitely puts in a pressure on them in terms of accountability.
Yeah.
So these are various facets, but important is this has not been made, this even in this present circumstances, it is not being made, it is not being popularized. The state doesn't want to popularize it. That's the reason why we say citizens must not only popularize it, but also start making use of it. You know, they have an office just here at Cooperage. The MTNL office is there. They have a full-fledged office there. Important is we must access this so that we can start documenting it and then use that as part of the process to say if, because honestly speaking, nobody knows what's the end result of the, when you file a complaint with them, how long will it take? When it, something happen, and then people will get disillusioned at the end of the day. Yes, Prina?
So are these structures disseminated? Do people know that these kinds of structures and mechanisms, you know, are available at different places? Because that would also be one way of getting people to use it, is to make it, you know.
No, we are talking to groups.
Yeah,
we
or
are doing public
a website awareness. Or something.
We have a Facebook page,
we have
a website.
You know, district level numbers. And you know, so state level numbers available so that people know that they can access it, and you will have people accessing it.
In before the end of the month, I think we'll be able to give you a couple of pages on the PCA.
Yeah.
We'll definitely be able to do that. Just to give you some idea of the resources, over the last, the PCAs in different states have been functional. And for several years, all my stories are very sad. So, for several years, CHRI has been monitoring PCAs. There are about 17 or 18 of them. And they've been coming up. First, we've been pressing states that they must set up PCAs. And then set them up according to the Supreme Court's orders. There we get defeated. Because once you say set up X, then the legislation, you are not in control of. You're not in control of the ordinance, and whatever they may say, in the end, the larger voices, the stronger voices, are that of the police. So a lot of subversion takes place. Then we monitor them to see whether the composition, there's an enormous amount of vacancies. Then at the level of ministerial staff, administrative staff, support staff, researchers, investigators, nothing, because nothing is being mandated very well. And then at the end of it, what is the power of that order to be actually compulsory on the government? Where we have seen it compulsory, government has done all sorts of things to delay, including refusing compensation, arguing about the technical wording, going to the appeal in the Supreme, going in appeal to the courts of the state, creating arguments, etc. So very little gets implemented. In Kerala, where there are two district level ones. One takes care of the north and one of the south. Not district level, they are district judges, but they are PCAs. Again, the big problem, and I should tell you, in Kerala, it has worked a little bit because of the general standard and culture of Kerala. But in other places, there's just no question of it working. In one of the states, I think it was Uttarakhand, I may be wrong, so please don't quote me on this, we could not even find the telephone numbers of the people who had complained because the gateway person had not bothered to take. And the people who come to complain have such a power asymmetry between the person who's even taking your complaint and this person that there's no question of his having the guts to say, well, why haven't you taken this? Why haven't you taken that? It's just quite dreadful. Now, you see that they say that either a Supreme Court or a High Court judge should be the head of a PCA. Now, which Supreme Court judge is going to bring himself down to the level of being part of a non-binding PCA in some odd state? Just no question of it. They won't even take up jobs as state human rights commission, heads of state human rights commission. There are three Supreme Court judges who I know who live in Bombay, And they just laugh, Maya, are you mad? Is anybody going to take up this? Or even the State Human Rights Commission. So you always get the out-of-work judge who's been sidelined who gets these jobs. And he doesn't have to have any training, he doesn't have to have any background in human rights or policing or police complaints or specialization. Then you have, to my mind, the greatest fraud on us people is the fact that you have the member secretary or a member of the commission being a policeman.
Serving officer.
How are you going to bring a complaint against me if I am the judge? There is no effort to make the playing field level. There is every knowledge that the playing field is not level and you're bloody going to keep it that way. This is my great complaint. I just wonder whether we should even be bothering. Should we just scrap the whole thing and start all over again? I don't know. When the State Security Commission was first made here, there were 65 members. It had happened just after that terrible Taj and whatever, what do you call it? 11-9-9-11. What? 26-11, yeah. So that had happened. So everybody got all excited. Chief Minister said, we will have everybody, all the citizens, come together. There were 60, 65 members. They called it something, but it was essentially the State Security Commission, right? And I was looking down the name, and I saw the name of Javed Akhtar. Now, he's a great guy. He writes beautiful poems. But seriously? On the State Security Commission? So, when you're making a joke of everything for the citizens because you have so much contempt for the citizens. So, just to end the session, if everything had been done the way it should have been done, you would have had a mechanism for setting down policy and accountability to the legislature and therefore to the people. You would have had three machineries to bring management firmly back into the hands of the police. You would have had within the police, if the PEB functioned properly, for the juniors to have a forum which was transparent, which would show them on merit how their careers were going up, rather than favoritism, rather than giving men